This video is an introduction to nSpace, which is an app I'm developing for iOS and Android. nSpace lets you build 3D interactive worlds. You can sculpt spaces in 3D, add objects that move or have physics, and wire the components of your world together to add interactivity and build games. It's similar to a level editor you might use for a video game, but it's designed to be very open-ended with the types of worlds that it lets you build. You're not limited to just game levels. You can make atmospheric environments, or puzzles, or machines, all experienced from a first-person perspective. In this video, I'll give a quick tutorial on the main features of the app. nSpace also includes built-in interactive tutorials, which I recommend you follow. To start, I'm going to create a new world and give it a name. Skip the tutorial for now. You can come back to it later. This is the room that you start out with. You can use two-finger and three-finger gestures to look around. In nSpace, you work with interior spaces. You could call it negative space. Rooms are created not by building walls, but by carving out empty space. You can see that as I look around the room, the walls facing away from me disappear, so I can see inside. The green person at the center of the room is you when you play your world. You can press play to take control of the green person and walk around the room. There's not much here, so let's try building something. The main action for building in nSpace is pushing and pulling. This is done by selecting a rectangular region of the wall using one finger, and dragging one of these arrows, in particular, the one that is perpendicular to the wall, which in this case is the red arrow. If you move the arrow into the wall, that's a push, and you carve into the wall. If you move the arrow out of the wall, that's a pull, and you build out of the wall. With a series of pushes, we can build a hallway, make it bend around, and connect to a separate room. One gesture you'll find useful is the double tap to select an entire wall. With a few pulls, we can build some structures in the room, like a staircase or a column. Notice how I can no longer pull once my column reaches the top of the room. The top of the column merges with the ceiling. In the same way, I can split the room into two separate rooms by dividing across the center of the room. I can make a new opening in this barrier I've created by pushing a hole through the wall. Notice again that the push stops once I've completely carved through the wall. Once you've sculpted the shape of your world, you can paint it. Select a region of a wall again, and tap the paint icon. There are over 100 materials for you to choose from, divided into categories. If none of those work for you, you can also choose a color along with a finish, such as glossy or metallic. In addition to materials, there are overlays, which are painted on top of another material. One use for overlays is to paint text or symbols on the walls. Also notice these buttons that let you rotate and flip the paint. One of the most interesting materials is sky. In the editor, this only appears as a tiled pattern, but when you play your world, it becomes a window to the sky. This window isn't just a hole in the world, it actually obscures everything behind it. Try painting a column in the middle of your room with sky and walking around it. This effect allows you to create some interesting illusions or seemingly impossible spaces. For example, this building seems small until you walk inside. You can change the sky under the World Options menu. Different skies can contribute to the atmosphere of the world, and they also affect the lighting. Before we move on to all the other features of nSpace, there's a lot you can build just by sculpting and painting. I'd encourage you to experiment with building different types of worlds and exploring them in first person. One feature which I won't cover in this video, but which you'll probably enjoy, is bevels. These can be used to build structures that are more complex than just cubes. There's a tutorial in the app on how to use them. Next, we will add some substances. These are the first step into making dynamic and interactive worlds. Select a rectangle on the floor and tap this cube button. We will build a water substance first. Now try pushing down into the floor. As you carve a hole into the floor, it gets filled up with water. Now press play and go for a swim. Substances are separate objects from the walls that form the boundaries of the world. When you build a column in a room, it merges with the ceiling. But substances never merge with the rest of the world. They are completely detached, and because of this, they can move around independently. Next, we will build a block substance. Select a single square on the floor, tap the cube button, choose solid substance, and pull up to make a block. This time, pay attention to the panel that appears on the left side of the screen. This lists some important properties of the substance that you can change. Below those, you can choose a sensor, which we'll talk about later, but right now we'll focus on the third section, which are the behaviors. Behaviors control how the substance behaves when you play the world. This cube has visible and solid behaviors, which means you can see it and you can't walk through it. The water has visible and water behaviors. Besides that, in a different coat of paint, there is no other difference between the two substances. Try adding a physics behavior to the cube. It's under the physics category. When you play the world, you can kick around the cube. If you kick it into the water, it will float. You can make it sink instead by adjusting the density of the cube, or the density of the water. Higher densities will make the cube harder to push. Next, we will build an elevator. First, make a ledge, which the elevator will lift you up to reach. Next, build your elevator as a solid substance carved into the floor. To make the elevator move up, add a move behavior and change its direction to up. Now you have an elevator that moves up, but the best elevators don't just go up, they also come down. To do this, the elevator needs to switch between two separate move behaviors. This is where sensors come in. Sensors change objects between two states, on and off, based on their environment or connections to other objects. For this elevator, you'll use a pulse sensor, which flips on and off in a simple repeated pattern. Now you need to determine how long it should take to switch. The move behavior is set to move at 1 meter per second, which means that the number of seconds it takes to reach the top is the same as the height of the ledge. Endspace includes a virtual measuring tape for this purpose. Drag your finger to select all the way to the top, and a number at the top of the screen will tell you the dimensions of your selection. Put that number into the off time and the on time. Now you can add the move behavior that makes the elevator go down. And to make it switch between the two, set the up behavior to be active when the sensor is off, and the down behavior to be active when the sensor is on. Now you can take the elevator to the top and back down again. Endspace also includes a tutorial called Advanced Game Logic 1, which tells you how to build a more sophisticated elevator with multiple floors and buttons. The final machine that we'll build will be a sliding door. Build a corridor, and on one side of the corridor, carve a gap that a door could slide into. Next, build the door itself using a solid substance. Like our elevator, the door will have two move behaviors to make it move in opposite directions. It slides open when it's on and closed when it's off. Unlike the elevator, we won't be using a pulse sensor. Instead, we want the door to open when we walk up to it. To do this, we'll use another type of substance called a trigger. Again, triggers are no different than any other substance, except that by default, they are neither visible nor solid, and instead come with a touch sensor. This means that the trigger can act as an invisible region which uses the touch sensor to detect when you have walked inside. Currently, the trigger activates when any object enters. Change the filter so it only activates when the player walks inside. Choose specific object, then tap the player and press the check mark. Notice the red wire connecting our trigger to the player, showing they are now related. We now need to make the door activate when the trigger turns on. We effectively need to wire the door to the trigger. This is done using a threshold sensor on the door, which lets you connect multiple inputs to other objects. We'll add only one input and connect it to the trigger. There is one remaining problem which you'll notice as soon as you play your world. The door slides right through the wall. Though the door is solid, there is nothing stopping it from doing this. To solve this, you can give the door physics behavior, so it obeys the laws of physics. Normally, a physics behavior would also mean that you could push the door and make it fall over, but the move behaviors will stop this from happening. Now you have a functioning door. The threshold sensor opens up some possibilities for puzzle games. You could set it so it takes two or more inputs to activate, then make multiple challenges you have to complete to open the door. This has been a basic overview of what's possible with Endspace. There are more features I didn't mention, like balls and targeted behaviors, which you can learn about by following the tutorials. Again, I encourage you to explore all the options available based on what I've covered so far. Try all the different behaviors. You can learn more about how they work by tapping the question mark icon. Also try the different sensors. There are many ways to wire objects together to build complex game logic. You can also look at the demo worlds for inspiration. One of the most extensive is Platform Game, which shows how to combine the elements I've talked about to make a game level. Unfortunately, it has a few issues with speed and frame rates on some phones. This is one of the less polished areas you might have to deal with in NSpace. It's a work in progress, and I have many features that I'm planning to add. But I think I've included enough right now to give you a very wide range of possibilities to explore. If you make something you like, you can share it with the world by tapping Share on the main menu. I've created an official NSpace subreddit for discussing and posting your creations. At the time I'm recording this, it has 2 subscribers, so you could be the 3rd. Thank you for watching, and I hope you enjoy using NSpace. If you have any questions or feedback, please send me an email.